Greetings, I'm Mr. Spiffy, and welcome to the Bottom of the Barrel. And we are continuing today with my Spiffy Q&A week, as we are in part two of the three-part series throughout this week. More questions from you, some of them from the same people, and I've learned how to pronounce some of your usernames. Thank you so much for getting to me and telling me, you know, if you want it pronounced properly, you know, you gotta tell me. Otherwise, I'm probably gonna botch it. I'm gonna go seen Kara all over it. Yeah, you like it when I seen Kara your name. Yeah. I don't know what the hell I just said there. Anyway, let's start from the top. NJ17, which, by the way, really nice guy on, I've talked to him a bit on Twitter, and he's been messaging me on YouTube. I wanted to say to him, before I answer his question, thank you so much for the link to your streaming site. It's been very useful and helpful. I appreciate it very much. NJ17, he writes, DX, choose the time that they were together with the members, and NWO, choose the time that they were together with members and why. I had to ask him about this, what he meant, and what he meant was that which version of DX did I like, and which version of the New World Order did I prefer, and why. DX, I preferred prior to Triple H becoming WWF champion for the first time, where it was Pac, the Outlaws, and Triple H and China. Solid group there. They ran roughshod over everybody. Their battles with the Nation were amazing. The NWO was probably at its most, DX was probably at its most interesting at that time. As for the NWO, I got to go with the original crew. Up until just about the time they got Six-Pac in there with Hall, Nash, Hogan, well, minus the fake Sting. I don't give a crap about him. Ted DiBiase. And my reason behind that is just because they had that great old-school feel and you knew that they were going to cause trouble. And it was before the NWO got way too convoluted. And while the NWO did gain certainly some decent members in getting Kurt Hennig and DX's old running buddy Ravishing Rick Rude and others like that, the original core group was probably, in my opinion, the best. And anything beyond that was just kind of overkill. And admittedly, I didn't watch a lot of WCW. When the wars really, really got hot and heavy around 1999, 98-99, I pretty much chose sides. And I sided with the WWE. And I ran with them, and they in turn, you know, they wound up winning the war. So, I'm good at picking sides. Yeah. Whatever good that does me. Alright. Question number two comes from Tracy Prince, or as his handle on Twitter is, Trasty McNasty. I don't know, that's kind of cool. Tracy asks, do I play Madden on PS3 or Xbox? And yeah, I've played Madden for the Sega Genesis back in 1991. I'm old, ladies and gentlemen. Just in case you forgot, I'm in my 30s. I've never been a big football guy. I do watch some football, and I've just never really had any friends who were like big into the Madden games. My friends, when I was growing up, they didn't really play much of the football games. Most of what we played was we would play Mario, we would play a lot of the Final Fantasy games, that kind of stuff. I got heavily into the RPGs, and of course we played the wrestling games. I especially loved playing like the old classic like Royal Rumble game for the Super Nintendo. That was a lot of fun, and the WWF Raw game for Super Nintendo. Also a really enjoyable classic games. I wish I had copies of those still. And they were simplistic, and probably they were among the best things that LGN ever created, which, you know, LGN is not exactly known for creating really stellar video games. But as it came for Madden, I had one friend who had the Madden game, and I just sort of fumbled my way through it, all pun intended. And I just sort of randomly chose different moves and different plays, and I either did it or not, and I just sort of mashed the three buttons on the Genesis controller and hoped for the best. So, sorry, if you were looking to play Madden with me online, sorry to disappoint. It's not my thing, you know. It doesn't mean I wouldn't sit down and play it if a friend had it out and whatnot. I'd probably fuck up the whole thing and lose more often than not, because people who play Madden are really hardcore at it, at least the ones I've noticed who do play. They tend to be like that type that's just there, and they want to keep doing more and more with it. So, and I hear it's a good series overall. Questions number 3 and 4 are coming from Seth Parker. And Seth's first question is, do I think Punk will get mizzed by facing Lawler? He more specifically said facing Lawler is never a good thing lately. And no, I don't think it's going to kill his run. I think that the WWE is trying everything they can. I think they overestimate the face-drawing power of Jerry Lawler. They figure if CM Punk turns on Lawler and beats the high holy hell out of him, that the fans are going to turn on him lickety-split. And it's not going to happen because they still have a solid thing. I think he did a decent job of trying to turn his own audience in Chicago. Teaming him up with Paul Heyman now is certainly a decent way to get the audience against him. Except for the hardcore audience like ourselves. But, you know, the casual fan will remember that Heyman is Brock Lesnar's representative. And, you know, maybe that'll do something for him. But I don't think going with Lawler is going to hurt his career. And I certainly don't see them dedicating a pay-per-view match like they did with The Miz. It was just when The Miz was WWE champion, they really had nobody to face him. Or they weren't focused on it. Which, you know, was unfortunate for The Miz. And frankly, at that time, I was rooting on The King. But I don't think it's going to hurt CM Punk, really. And the next question was, don't you think we lack any good names lately? I mean, there are no more one-word names or names that truly represent the wrestler's gimmick and personality. Lately, the WWE simply gives them fake names and surnames. Derek Bateman, Seth Rollins, which sounds terrible comparison to Tyler Black. Darren Young, I get the idea, yeah. So I do. That's pretty true. The funny thing is that you get a bit more from FCW NXT than you do generally from the standard public. But yeah, they do just like to give them names and surnames because they're trying to make them more real. They're putting them there, and it's like the WWE has kind of lost its balance between having wrestlers who are names and then gimmicks. I mean, take WWE versus the NWA, WWF versus the NWA back in the 1980s. Their main, WWF's main feature attraction were all gimmick characters. Hulk Hogan, Macho Man, all of these guys who were very high and over-the-top personalities. And then you had, you know, admittedly strong personality, but like Ric Flair's and Dusty Rhodes and Ricky Steamboat. You had these guys who were very solid and basic, and it was a real contrast. When the WWE hit the mid-90s, they really got into the cheesy gimmicks. And then right around the Attitude Era, they built a nice, I'd say, even playing field, where about half were gimmicky and the other half were first name, last name kind of deals with a little moniker in front of them. And I think the moniker is really what it's missing, is nobody gives a crap about Derek Bateman, but they might give a crap about the Destroyer Derek Bateman. And it just, you know, I'm just pulling shit out of my ass there. But what I'm saying is that, you know, if they do give them a moniker, give them something, yes, I agree that it probably would help. And, you know, I could see the WWE starting to go back towards that. I mean, we still have a few like Sin Cara and, you know, Bray Wyatt, which Bray Wyatt, yes, is a first name, last name, total fake surname. Of course, so is Husky Harris. But at least it's more interesting and it's got a character to it, so can't go wrong there. Alright, so apparently I mispronounced this, I did this one wrong last time, so get it right this time. Daleks Man, I might still be mispronouncing it, asks, would I agree that Shawn Michaels versus The Undertaker at WrestleMania 25 is the greatest match in history? No. No, I would not. I can't say it's the greatest match in history. Is it the greatest match in recent history? I'd say yes. And the only match that's even coming that any closer to nipping at its heels, in my opinion, is CM Punk versus John Cena at Money in the Bank 2011. But the one that match in modern history, I'd say in like the last 5 to 6 years, yes, that has been definitely one to stand out and hold a place holding. In all of history, if you've seen my greatest matches of all time and video, which I did my top, I think I did a top 20 on that. My number one match of all time, and still to this day is Bret the Hitman Hart versus Shawn Michaels in a 60-minute Iron Man match at WrestleMania 12. This match for me epitomized the concept of wrestling and going the distance and showing what two average size, which are considered small build wrestlers, can do on a grand stage, and with the opportunity to go ahead and make such a grandiose and take an hour of a 3-hour pay-per-view, but make it an exciting and an edge of your seat hour. And I have yet to see a match like that since. The only one that came close to doing it was the following year with Bret Hart versus Steve Austin. Generally, I'm a more technical wrestling fan, and so those catch-as-catch-can back and forth, near fall after near fall, these guys are just hauling ass and doing whatever they can, and they're going out there and doing these 60-minute Broadways. Those are amazing matches. That's so old school for me, and I enjoy that kind of matchup. Shawn Michaels versus The Undertaker had a lot of heart and a lot of spirit and told a great in-ring story. But in the end, I don't think, from a technical standpoint, is it the greatest match in history, because certainly there are ones that are better. But if I were to rank it, I would say that definitely it's got a solid place in history, at least in the top 50 matches of all time in professional wrestling. Okay, so the next question comes from the Renegade 102. He said, this one's a tough one. Without turning him heel or bringing back Thuganomics, what would you do with John Cena to stop the older fans from booing him? About the only thing I could really do with Cena would be, you don't have to bring back Thuganomics, but I think that Cena needs to be dialed back from the undefeatable god type. You know, he can't be Super Cena all the time. And I would probably bring back the Cena who, you know, is ruthless aggression. When the closest they came to really getting Cena to not be booed was when he was attacking Kane and sort of embracing the hate. He doesn't need to embrace hate, but he needs that ruthless aggression again. And I know the words ruthless aggression have a negative stigma on them thanks to name deleted. Chris Benoit. I don't have a fear of saying it. Chris Benoit. Because that was his moniker. Ruthless aggression. And the WWE wants to forget about ruthless aggression. But the fact is, that's exactly what Cena is missing. Cena is, I get in the ring, I get beat down, I make a comeback, I do a few moves that we all know, and then I win. To put it succinctly, I think The Miz put it most succinctly this last Monday on Raw. That's a maneuver we've seen from Cena many times. Yeah, Cena needs to just tweak his attitude and could probably come off a bit more aggressive and a bit more vicious instead of like smiling like, I'm taking your shit and it's okay. You see, that, if he changed that, I think that he would garner some of his lost fans back. And then he also, Renegade wanted to ask me if I ever played the Slender Man game. Never even heard of it, to be perfectly honest. What system is it for? Is it a computer game? What is it? What is it about? Unfortunately, your thing doesn't tell me anything about it, and I didn't find much time to actually go look it up. So, sorry, dude. Don't play the game. Zach Holker asked, could I see the WWE Championship being swapped with the World Heavyweight Championship in the next 5 years? Meaning, you know, will they switch brands? I don't know. For all I know, the World Heavyweight Championship could get absorbed into the WWE title in the next 5 years. WWE could go out of business in the next 5 years. Yeah, they could possibly switch. The problem is, what does it matter? At this point, it doesn't really matter. The only reason why it matters is blue briefcase or red briefcase. Because with the blue briefcase, you get the World Heavyweight Championship. With the red briefcase, you get the WWE title. That's all that really matters about it. It makes no real difference beyond that at where it is. All it means is if they were to swap them, it means that the blue briefcase gets the WWE title and the red briefcase gets the World Heavyweight title. Until they actually separate the brands and make them an actual brand split again, it doesn't matter. It really doesn't. Mr. Largest 85, my friend. Alright, let's see what you got for me this time. What if John Cena came out to a chorus of boos? Oh, that already happens. And he got in the ring and couldn't take the boos anymore. And he started to cry. And ran out crying buckets of tears. How would I look at him then, real or not kayfabe? I would look at him as a man who probably needs some serious psychotherapy or maybe some, you know, medication, because he's got some sort of weird pituitary mix-up or some sort of thing in his brain where he's utterly depressed. Means the man probably needs some help, you know? And, I can't see that happening to Cena. Cena's a professional performer. And it would also be silly. I'd probably laugh at it a little bit. But I, overall, as a humanitarian, I would be concerned for him. And say, probably suggest that he go seek help and take time off from the WWE and maybe not wrestle for a while. Yeah, so that's about it. I think you're a shot. I think you're shooting himself in the head question. Was a bit more poppy. Maybe I should have saved that one for later. Oh, Real Spider-Man Noir fan says, what are my thoughts on Raven as Johnny Polo? Well, and I'm guessing that you're probably looking at this at the point of view because of you probably saw him as Raven first. And then you saw old footage and you saw stuff of him as Johnny Polo. I'm just assuming here. If I'm wrong, I'm wrong. But generally, you see, when I saw him as Johnny Polo, I was already used to him in that character style because the first time I saw Raven, or Johnny Polo, was back on Clash of the Champions back in 1992 during the WCW Light Heavyweight title tournament. I saw him as Scotty Flamenco taking on Brad Armstrong. So, Scotty Flamenco was just as weird and, you know, just as... Actually, if anything, he was probably even more than Johnny Polo was. I liked the Johnny Polo character. I thought he was decently egotistical. He got to talk more than he did as Scotty Flamenco. And certainly, you know, he went out there and managed one of the more interesting tag teams in the Quebecers with probably one of the most impressively, happily annoying songs in history. So, I didn't have a problem with it. I actually watched his natural progression. And, actually, him becoming Raven was the bigger shock for me because I didn't watch ECW. I didn't catch up with ECW until after ECW was already established. So when I suddenly saw him as Raven, I'm like, wait, is that Johnny Polo? That was my reaction. So, it was kind of a total different thing for me, but I'm used to him as Raven, and although Raven in the skirt was a little odd for me. Although I did actually dress as Raven for Halloween at one point, so there you go. Next question comes from Naboxid. He asks me, which wrestlers do you think are either unsuccessfully pushed by the brass, unnecessarily pushed, pardon me, by the brass, or underappreciated and why? Unnecessarily pushed stars? Who? Alberto Del Rio. I'm sorry, you know, I know he's a decent wrestler in the ring, but his gimmick was interesting at first. Actually, no, I take that back. His gimmick was boring as fuck. I used to fall asleep during his long-ass vignettes. His vignettes went nowhere fast, and it was the most boring thing. If that's what they did to hype him up and anticipate for him, it wasn't very good. He made immediate impact, and I was a fan of his on immediate impact and how he came in. But after a while, when you start with a flat grade in your moment, and you just let momentum ride, eventually it's going to slow down. And that's more or less what's happened to Alberto Del Rio, is that he hasn't changed. His gimmick went flat really, really quick. It's amazing how quickly something can go stale in just a matter of 2 years. And that's effectively what happened to Alberto Del Rio. As for unappreciated, I think Christian doesn't get enough appreciation for what he does. I mean, I think he's probably one of the better stars, and I think that he deserved a far greater world title reign than either one of the ones that he had. And I'd like to see him hit the top of the rung one more time, but I don't think it's going to happen. Other underappreciated stars are... I think Alex Riley could use a gimmick change. I think he's an underappreciated talent. He's a great in the ring, but I don't think much of his character, especially because he doesn't really have one anymore. His varsity villain character was much more interesting. Now he just is white meat happy guy in varsity jacket. It doesn't go over very well and translate very well to intimidating superstar. So, while I think he's underappreciated, I think that he needs a kind of a whole gimmick refresh. So, those would be mine. Next, I did 4 questions on this one. It's probably because of the fact that this one was one of the ones that gave me 10. Next 4 questions come from Final Limits. And first question is, what is my favorite wrestling games and why? You know, shout out to doubt, today, my favorite game is WWE SmackDown Here Comes the Pain. That was one of the last really good WWE games that I could just play with and have fun with. And I created more wrestlers with that one than probably any other game. I had to extend over to multiple memory cards. Not because they only allow 4 created wrestlers per card, but because I filled up all 25 spots or whatever it was on one card and had to move to my next PS2 memory card. I love doing it, and some of my creative stuff was... I think it came out really well, and you'll get to see it down the road here. As I do. So, definitely one of my favorites. It had probably the least amount of glitches. When they started switching over to the 3D stuff for the SmackDown versus Raw games, that's where I started running into a lot of problems with my CAWs, and I started getting less enthused because it took me so much longer to create interesting and fun superstars. And there was just so many layer limitations. And I understand it's part... when you go into more advanced rendering, obviously you have to have less... layering and stuff, but it would be nice to have a little more freedom in my structure. Would I pay to see Hogan from the 80s versus Cena today? Yes. And because that's a match I couldn't predict. I really couldn't predict who would win. If you had, I guess it depended on who was booking it, but Cena versus 80s Hogan, I mean, yes, besides the fact that it's pretty much the same guy versus the same guy, both of these men elicited a great audience, reaction. And if you took, if you took the audience, like 50% were 80s Hogan's fan, take the people, transplant half the audience from the 80s and half the audience from today, I would say transplant like the women and children, obviously, the ones who are going to cheer Cena, and let that be the audience. I think you would have a really solid matchup just because of the audience energy alone. Wouldn't be the best technical match, but what are you going to do? Would I like to see Dolph Ziggler of today versus Macho Man of 1986? I don't know. Personally speaking, I would have loved to have seen Chris Jericho from maybe like 2-3 years ago versus not like 1980 versus maybe 1987, 88 Macho Man. I think they would have some great technical matches. Ziggler versus Macho, they're not, their styles aren't, I can't say would necessarily mesh too well. But it doesn't mean it wouldn't be a bad match. It would be a bad match. It just means that I can't quite wrap my head around it. Who knows? And the last one is Macho Man versus CM Punk. Good or bad match? Good. Duh. See, now when I was picturing a match, a modern day star versus Macho Man of the classic era, those two are the ones that I think about. Especially because of Punk's homages to Macho Man. His homages could easily turn into mockings of Macho Man. And Randy Savage had just as much charisma and anti-hero as anything you could find in the 1980s. So those two would be an interesting dynamic. Just to hear the promos alone between the two of them leading up to the match would make the match worthwhile. God, that would be some crazy shit. All right. We're going into strange territory again. Cancerous Mike Work asks me, what do I think of Kelly Kelly's vagina? And would I lick it like lum, 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 soy, soy, soy? Who does the what now? First of all, let's take the first half of this question. What do I think of Kelly Kelly's vagina? Well, to be perfectly honest, I've never given Kelly Kelly's vagina much thought. I assume it's a vagina. I mean, you know, there's probably nothing all that strange or different about Kelly Kelly's vagina, unless it looked like this. And in which case, then, yeah, I'd say that there was a problem. Otherwise, no, probably not. I don't think there's an issue. She probably has a very ordinary-looking vagina. Might be a bit stretched out, considering her reputation. Speaking of which, would I lick that vagina? Hells no. First of all, I'm a married man. And I'm quite happily married. And if Kelly Kelly offered me up her fishy dish, I probably wouldn't be interested in it. Simply because of the fact that I've dated the slutty types over the years, and I've fooled around with the slutty types a couple of times, and let's be perfectly honest, it's not all it's cracked up to be. Usually, when you date a woman who is so used to fucking that fucking means nothing, this is usually, no matter what you try to do, if you really care for her, even if you're trying to please her, it's usually this. Okay, uh-huh, all right, uh-huh, yeah, okay, good, thanks. Put it in now. Okay, is it in? Oh, I'm sorry. Let me see if I can find a way to tighten up my pussy. No, not working. Sorry, I'm just too loose because I've had 20 dicks in me at one time. You know, it's not really what you would call a real good outcome. Yeah, so no. He also asks, what diva would I fuck the shit out of? Now, that's just plain gross. I mean, I've had sex with a few different women, and I've certainly brought my wife to orgasm many times through sexual intercourse, but never have I been mid-coitus and suddenly fecal matter comes flying out of my partner just shooting all over the place. That's damn disgusting and dirty. I don't know what kind of sick pornographic material you're watching, fella, but seriously, yuck! Ugh! No! What? Oh, would I fuck her to an orgasm? Again, I'm married, but for the divas, I actually tend to find a little bit more of the lustier, bustier women who aren't plastic. So most of the WWE divas aren't attractive to me. I find Beth Phoenix reasonably attractive, and I've found Mickey James attractive. But, you know, beyond that, not much. It's not my bag. I prefer my wife. What can I say? I'm a decent married man. The next two questions come from Drake234234, because repeating numbers is cool. He says, "Hi, Mr. Spiffy. Who is your favorite Attitude Era superstar and PG Era superstar? And would you like to see them go one-on-one?" Only if they're in their prime. Let me start with the back end of the question. Would I like to see them go one-on-one? Only if they're both in their primes. Take the prime version from the Attitude Era and the prime version from the current era. If I were to say PG Era stars, CM Punk. If I were to go Attitude Era, Mankind. And I mean the Mankind who first came out and was managed by Paul Bearer and was just straight nuts. That one, that version of Mankind, absolutely loved it. And he was definitely one of those that I felt was just downright evil. And I, again, it all comes down to promos. I would love to hear the back and forth promos between old lived in the basement Mankind and CM Punk. I think it would make a decent match. And it would probably, if you had the gloves off and let it go, that could be probably one of the most brutal and violent matches you'd ever seen, with a wonderful mix of hardcore and technical, and you don't get that very often. He also asks, why is it that Raw is 3 hours and they don't push any of the jobbers, well, you mean the lower or mid-card guys, or put them on Raw for the first hour like A-Rai, Drew, Kidd, and all of them? Because the WWE doesn't view the whole audience. First of all, the only way that that would work and that they could actually do that is that they need to separate the brands again. SmackDown be SmackDown and Raw be Raw. When you've got SmackDown guys constantly over on Raw, it doesn't make a difference. Those wrestlers are lost in the shuffle. Hell, there are certain wrestlers who are still technically under contract who haven't been seen on any show, not even on fucking Superstars, in well over a year. Ezekiel Jackson, Trent Beretta, you know, just to name a couple there. I mean, you know, there are guys who just, you know, they're non-existent. And unfortunately, you're right. These guys are suffering for it. And some of these guys definitely deserve the push. Tyson Kidd definitely deserves a push back to the top. Drew McIntyre, A-Rai with a little bit of a rehash to his character. They deserve a chance to get up and do something more. And I think that first hour should be used to put those guys over. It's not. So, what are you going to do? It just is what it is. Next three questions come from I Love Watermelons 525. He's apparently obsessed with my hair. Because the next three questions are all about my hair. First of all, how long have I had my long hair for? I started growing out my hair back in 1997. So, if you add up the time, there you go. How long did it take your hair to be that long? Well, I've shortened it up to here and down and stuff. I've trimmed it over the years. At one point, it was nearly halfway down my back, and I eventually cut it off just because it was getting to the point where I hadn't trimmed it in years, and it was getting very stringy, and so the last few, it was just like little, like 12 or 12, 15 strands coming down the back of my back. So, yeah, it wasn't looking too well. And he says, and do I ever plan on cutting off my hair? Not if I intend to continue getting laid, because my wife likes my long hair. She doesn't want me in short hair. The pictures she's seen of me when I had short hair back when I was 15, of course, admittedly, when I was 15, I was pretty damn gangly, but it's not me. I'd wind up, with my high forehead, I'd wind up looking probably like a less than distinguished Patrick Stewart, or maybe I'll look like an overweight Stone Cold Steve Austin. Either way, it's not really a good look for me. So, and this guy, he also made sure I say his name right, so this next three questions are from Joey S-O-A-D fan, because they were supposed to be separated, but apparently YouTube doesn't let him do that. And he said, other than the wonderful Katie Vick storyline, which storyline were you the most uncomfortable watching? If I were to say the one that I was probably the most uncomfortable with, there are two that come to mind, and they both involve Eddie Guerrero. One of which was Eddie's mom, the matriarch of the Guerrero family, having a heart attack in the middle of the ring. Not very classy. Especially in the end, the irony of it all when Eddie died of a heart attack. And the other one for me was the whole, I'm your puppy! Eddie Guerrero claiming that he knocked up Rey Mysterio's wife, and he was the father of Rey's son. Rey's son is already taller than his daddy. It's just funny. So yeah, those two made me rather uncomfortable. So I'd say probably those. Do I like System of the Down? Hells yeah. Saw them last year. Made the mistake of being on the lawn over at Shoreline, which close to the front end of the whole pit. So being out there, I no longer really fear the zombie apocalypse because I have been in a tidal wave of human beings. And yeah, that was nuts. I spent most of the time holding on to my wife, making sure that she didn't get knocked over or trampled or pulled away from me. That would not have been pleasant. And he says, "And what are my thoughts on the 7/2012 Aurora tragedy, the Batman shooting? You know, that just plain sucked. And society and the society that's breeding these people to do this kind of stuff, it's really hurtful. Because it makes it hard for me to be a fan of anything. Because that could easily be a WWE event or other stuff. Thank God arenas at least like have the metal wands and check people for weapons, and you know their emergency doors aren't quite as easy to jimmy open as say the emergency exits on a movie theater. That was just some fucked up shit, and I feel really bad for the people in Colorado, and my best to all of them, you know. And I'm proud of the guys who did their who were smart and played dead, or took bullets for their women, you know, or in some cases took bullets for their men. As long as you know, those guys who really, you know, used their brains in there and didn't panic, I'm proud of you guys. And honestly, I hope that in the end, these people aren't truly traumatized for life. They're in the same boat that some of those people who were there at Hartford, Connecticut, when Owen Hart fell to his death. It's the same sort of situation. And I would never wish that on anybody, and I certainly would never want to be in a scenario where either I'm in an area where someone's shooting or witness to a violent death. I would just, it's not something I'd ever want to live with or ever wish that anybody had to live with. Jim Van Cleef, a longtime friend of mine for almost 15 years now, asks me, what's 5 times 4? I got 2 answers for that one, buddy. First answer is, it's the square footage of my cock. And now you know. Yeah. But the answer to that question is also 20, which also is the IQ of Thundercloud. Inside joke. Next question comes from Jeremy Arias. Should Drew McIntyre leave the WWE? I can't say that he would necessarily do any better anywhere else. I mean, you know, yes, TNA might use him, they might push him, but the TNA doesn't need more former WWE stars. Drew McIntyre needs to find a way not to leave the company, but to get himself noticed again. To convince Vince McMahon and those people that just because he didn't punch his ex-wife back doesn't mean that he's a pussy. It means that he's a good, solid man who actually respects women. So, Drew's gone through some tough times. They've given him some decent matches on NXT, and my hope is that with a little bit of revamping and the right push, he could come back and be better than ever. I hope, because I like Drew McIntyre. I think he's a very solid superstar. And the last question for tonight comes from T-shirts are too tight. And he asks, what is the most offensive gimmick to you in history? Most offensive wrestling gimmick in history? Well, Katie Vick was a storyline, so I guess I can't say that was a gimmick. Most offensive gimmick. You know, that's the hard one, because to be honest, there's not a lot that offends me. I mean, you know, I guess you could, there's a number of things that I could have found offensive over the years. I could have found Nick Dinsmore as Eugene as offensive, you know, because it's about retarded people. I could have found Goldust offensive because of all of the overt homosexual raciness that's making, you know, kind of making fun there and whatnot. I could easily find Kane's gimmick offensive because, you know, he burns people and tortures them. And if I, you know, there's a lot of gimmicks that have come and gone that could be considered offensive. If I were to say that any of them offended me, it's because they really offended my intelligence. And for offending my intelligence, the number one worst gimmick for me was Who. Yeah. The man known as Who, from Who's Knows Where and Ways Who Knows What. Who was offensive because, looking at his hairy gut, it was brutally obvious to me that it was Jim the Anvil Neidhart. And I found it offensive to my intelligence that they actually believed that any of us would believe that he was anybody but Jim the fucking Anvil Neidhart in yellow trunks and a yellow fucking mask. And I find it equally as offensive that they took a former WWF Tag Team Champion, a man who was a solid backbone for a tag team for nearly 10 years, and turned him into a piece of crap, while his former tag team partner and brother-in-law was becoming the WWF champion. That was a man who should have gotten a better singles push as Jim the Anvil Neidhart. And I was grateful when they took him out of the stupid mask and teamed him up with Owen Hart and created the New Hart Foundation, because at least that was something that made sense. So, that's it for this particular round. We got one more round of questions coming down the line. I will probably have that out either, probably Saturday at some point during the day. I'm going to try to get it done early in the day, because I'm hoping Saturday I can go to the Retro Dome and do the Spaceballs quote-along over at the Retro Dome here in San Jose. So, I'm looking forward to that. And I'm looking forward to giving you guys the last of your Q&A. Some of you are still asking me questions. While I'm not going to respond in the video, I will gladly answer your questions through text and whatnot. So, and if chance comes by and I decide I want to do another Q&A another few months down the line, remember, I'll probably give again another week and give you a chance to get your questions in. I'm Mr. Spiffy, and this barrel's been scraped clean. For now.
What the f-